Yet, when we study it, when many investigators have studied it, we're studying that mixed bag, that mixed basket of fruit, so that when it comes time for the next investigator to do the study, to try to reproduce the biomarker that the first investigator studied, they just might happen to have more bananas in their basket than the first investigator had. So it will not come up as important or associated or significant. In science, we function not on an N equals one, not on a one-to-one basis. It's on what happens in that group. And it's all associated, like it or not, with a p-value. If it's not significant, and actually, again, Dr. Wood talked about this morning, for pharma to put money towards a drug in a clinical trial, it has to be, what was it, 30%, 40% difference or effect. So it's a percentage rate, and it's also a significance value in order for us to move forward. So again, biomarkers may be there, and they may be subtle, which makes it even more important that we know what it is that we're studying. XMRV is a good example, okay? We know that it is at very low levels now. And it's tricky also to coax it out of the cells that it's in. We know in CFS that it's present in some people and it's present in the blood cells. But even in those people that it's present in, the blood has to be handled very carefully and cultured and coaxed and babied along in order to be able to get this virus detected. Okay? And also, that obviously that's not very diagnostic. That's not very helpful for you. You know, Cindy's going to run back to her culture lab, which, by the way, she doesn't have, in order to grow these cells for the next 4 weeks. It's not very effective in and of itself. So sometimes, even for one biomarker, we might need a combination of technologies in order to make it valid. Does everybody understand that? So not just virus growing it, but detecting antibodies, detecting the DNA, et cetera. So I think the other reason that we haven't validated and reproduced many of our findings is that we've also had this evolution of technologies. In many ways, it's been great. It's been incredibly powerful. We have these very, very, very sensitive tools now. And Dr. Singh talked about this morning. We can detect almost nothing in a sample of, that's huge. Let me digress a little bit. Dr. Coffin, who's a retrovirologist, who was one of the original discoverers of XMRV, or murine leukemia virus, actually, he showed an example of putting, I think it was a drop of blood into a pool, literally. He did this experiment into his backyard pool and then was able to take samples and using a very sensitive technique was able to find the virus from that one drop of blood in this pool, thousands of gallons. That's great. Now we have this incredibly sensitive technology. However, it can also complicate the way that we interpret the significance of those findings. Okay? Finally, biomarkers, as I indicated in the beginning, are very expensive. It takes a lot of patience, a lot of controls. We can't interpret the finding without having the appropriate controls. And obviously, resources are important. I don't want this to be discouraging at all, because I think there's a way that we can get around all of these roadblocks, all of these hurdles, much more efficiently and effectively than we have. So in the morning, we had this nice little response system that everybody could press their button, but we don't have it right now. So I'm just going to ask for a show of hands. How many of you have a pretty good idea? Actually, I asked this one already. Most of you know what biomarkers are, right? Everybody has a good sense for them. We know that they vary. They vary across lifespan. They can be a variety of different things. What is needed in order to solve CFS? This is our new mantra that the CFS Association has taken on over the past year and a half. How are we going to solve CFS? That's right on. That is right on. She answered scientific evidence. We need scientific evidence. And what is scientific evidence? Again, it is the ability for investigators to reproduce the findings of others and then for that finding to be validated on a large scale. And that also translates into SOPs, standard operating procedures. In CFS, I think one of the things that has plagued us for 20 plus years is that people have not used standard operating procedures. Do we have any aerospace engineers in the audience? Do we have any engineers in the audience? What's a standard operating procedure to you? That's right. Okay, so it's something that's done in a very standardized, systematic manner to make something work. Okay. What we need to do, first of all, is have a standardized operating procedure that every investigator in CFS and fibromyalgia, for that matter, defines a person the same way. Okay, and gathers information the same way. That instrument, that pain instrument that Pfizer handed out. If we all agreed as a scientific and medical community to measure pain using that instrument, that would be a huge step towards standard operating procedure and defining pain in this community. We won't get, not all of you will answer that question, there won't be the same answers for that instrument, but it would be a standardized way of asking about pain. It's a perfect example. We also have to have a very standardized way of understanding your natural history. What is your history in this illness? How long have you been sick? How did you get sick? What have you used to treat yourself? Or what has your physician treated you with? All of this is part of your story, your history, which to date, no one has gathered that information in a standardized way. We also need to collect our biological samples in the same way, whether that be a salival sample, whether that be a blood sample, whether that be a stool sample. All of that is important. It's just poo, or it's just blood. But in fact, the time that you collect that sample can affect what is found in that sample. The types of medications that you are on can affect what's in that sample. Even more complicated is we have 20 different types of tubes that we can collect blood in. Each one of them has a specific reason for its design. A red top tube allows the blood to clot. A yellow top tube has a specific type of anticoagulant material in it. A green top tube has a different type of anticoagulant in it. Each one of these tubes has a specific design. Those details about that tube affect what you find in it. To date, we still have not standardized the way that we collect something as simple as blood in CFS. Okay, there are clinical procedures that have very standard operating procedures for a CBC, for example. There's a specific tube for a CBC, okay? But we haven't done it in our search for biomarkers for CFS. And again, that's why we're not getting the same answers. We also have to use standardized technology and publish the methods in a reproducible and a reliable way. If I go and bake my grandmother's cheese bread and it comes out absolutely, and this is a true story, by the way. My grandmother, rest her soul, she's passed. Great Italian cook. She came over on the boat from Italy. She made this to die for cheese bread. She had like a third grade education, so she didn't write and she didn't read. She passed her recipe on verbally. When my mother tried to help me figure out the recipe so that I could reproduce that bread, we guessed, you know, it was a trial and error. It was never written down. We never have been able to reproduce the way my grandmother did it. My aunt can, but anyway. So it's very important to be able to document what it is that you do so that others that are in different laboratories in different parts of the world can reproduce it exactly in a reliable way. This will result in also reproducing and validating the result. Okay? It's pretty much common sense. This, I propose, if we do these things, we will come much closer to solving CFS. And not if, it is when. And I say we are there now to be able to do these things. This is an example which I'm going to quickly go through of another organization. It's called the Myelin Repair Foundation, which is an organization that was founded in order to get treatments for multiple sclerosis. And they've established a model where they identify the types of patients, they know the type of sample, they've engaged specific types of researchers, and they've had a great success story. They've used SOPs, and since being founded in 2004, they have identified 150 targets. And two of these are already in validation phase. They're that close to being to the bench side. These are treatment targets for MS, and they've already identified 19 biomarkers. This is in 6 years' time. So we can do this. And we are doing it. We actually modeled an effort that is very similar to that model that I just showed you from the Myelin Repair Foundation. And we're calling it the Solve CFS Biobank. I handed out some pamphlets. I think I ran out. I think there might be a few more out on the table over there. They might have been moved to the back. That describes our biobank. And let me tell you why I think our biobank is important. And this is it right here. One of the reasons we have not been able to systematically reproduce and validate biomarkers in CFS is because we've all been doing it differently. The biobank is a way that, number one, allows each and every one of you or anyone who wants to participate in the biobank that has a diagnosis of CFS to participate in research. Okay, so that's one of the biggest reasons. It's no longer going to be just a population that individual investigators identify. It will be the population as a whole. And this resource is produced so that it collects information, clinical information, natural history information from each and every one of the people who participate in the biobank in the exact same way. Okay? So that's my first major step that I indicated was one of the hurdles for us to overcome in order to be able to do this in a standardized way. It also gives us the opportunity to collect biological samples, saliva, urine, blood, not only in a standardized way, but in a way that is the appropriate way for the type of thing an investigator is looking for.